Thank you. You know, it's interesting to me, being in the Texas Medical Center now since 1963, except for a couple years in Vietnam, that I've had an opportunity to personally witness the development of all the LVADs of consequence that are in use. And it's interesting that it should occur in Houston, because Houston had no particular importance in medicine, certainly before the 50s. And specifically, I want to end up with a brief survey of how the continuous flow blood pumps came about, because they all, of course, that are being used now came from my lab or around my desk. Now, one of the things one of my cardiologists told me about this, that I've implanted da-di-da and more heart transplants and more pumps. I have, but not because I wanted to. I did it because none of my associates wanted to. They were all basically in private practice, and I was the only one that had an academic salary. So, and you didn't get paid for these pumps much, at least comparatively speaking, and you were up all night, et cetera, et cetera. So I ended up doing nearly all of them. And why Houston, as I said, a lot of it had to do with this man, Dr. DeBakey. Now, Dr. DeBakey, as Dr. Cooley said in this picture of him, he looks a bit like Groucho Marx, if some of you remember him. And in fact, he looks a lot like Groucho Marx. But he wasn't very funny. He was very tough and very difficult taskmaster. But he built up a Baylor from a medical school that was on probation when he came here to, by the time I went in the early 60s, it was considered the best medical school in the South, certainly. This is the way it looked when he came here. Houston was known at the turn of the century for the timber and cotton. And you can see why it had timber, because it was at the edge of the East Texas forest. And you can see that little building in the midst of all that forest. There's this little building, and that is Baylor College of Medicine, which is the first one built in the Texas Medical Center. And Dr. DeBakey told me when he came here to interview, he actually heard gunshots, and the gunshots were actually coming from people hunting out in that woods. Anyway, Dr. Cooley was also from Houston, and he trained with Blaylock. This is very important. Little things in history determine all sorts of eventual destinations. And Cooley, since he worked with Blaylock was the first one to do any sort of corrective cardiac surgery of merit. And he did shunts. He never did open heart surgery in his life, but he did do the shunts. And Dr. Cooley, who was very adept surgically from the start, helped and actually did some of these procedures. Between them is Albert Starr, who developed the first valve that worked. This is the medical center, again, a little later, but its only importance is you see Methodist Hospital right in the middle, and in front of that is St. Luke's Hospital and the Texas Children's. And the importance of that is that since Dr. Cooley had worked with Blaylock, he had privileges at Texas Children's, which at that time was attached to St. Luke's. So the other Baylor surgeons all worked at Methodist, but Dr. Cooley, using this pathway, also had privileges at St. Luke's. Now, the early days of cardiac surgery, we know about Gibbons doing the first case in 1953 that succeeded in a woman who, the last time I checked, was still alive, who was about my age. And but the next three cases he did all died, and he quit doing heart surgery altogether. And this was something that Lillehei researched, that that was the only survivor of the first 20 cases. Now, Lillehei was a very important person in the history of heart surgery because he was the first person to actually do open heart surgery successfully. He did it by cross circulation. He did the one of his fellows' pregnant wife gave him the idea that perhaps the adult could support the child, because it was mainly congenital heart surgery in those days, long enough to allow for open heart surgery and allow it to be performed successfully. This is sort of the way it was hooked up, and it was undoubtedly the first really successful heart surgery. They also, Cooley went up there in the fall of 55, and he met DeWall, and DeWall was working on the first bubble oxygenator. Now, the bubble oxygenators were very traumatic to the blood, and no one that had it had survived. And they really were trying to use a sort of a copy of the Gibbon up there. Cooley came back, and he and his brother-in-law made this machine. He got it, it was a coffee maker, and he got it from a restaurant supply house. Somehow his brother-in-law had some connections there, and he used steel wool in the top to filter out the air, and he bubbled oxygen through the deoxygenated blood and out to the patient. Cooley, Lillehei, was the most important surgeon to nearly to everyone's feeling at this in the early days of heart surgery, because he was the first one to show it could actually be done successfully. But Lillehei, who I got to know very well in my life, and he really thought Cooley was the most important, because Cooley was the first one to do it with a heart-lung machine. And this is the first case he did. It was a post-infarct VSD, a hard case to do even today. And he operated on this man and corrected his VSD in April of 1956, and he reported it here. For that year of 1956, he reported doing 95 cases, and this was in the Texas Heart, the State of Texas Medical Journal, a very inconsequential medical journal. It was the first open heart surgery that was successful. It's interesting for this crowd to know that they started out just giving half the dose of heparin that we normally give. And he also used two pumps. He used a pump on the venous return side, then it went into the oxygenator, and then a pump on the exit, the arterial side. He cannulated both the superior and inferior vena cava just through the right atrial appendage. And this is another schematic of what he was doing, bubbling this blood to oxygenate it. And this is the reason Cooley got away with it, because he was so fast. And that was important in those days because of the destruction of the blood. You see this very short operative time correct this simple atrial septal defect. But it was very important. And he reported 95 cases with 9 acute deaths, more late deaths. But this was incredible at the time. And the Mayo Clinic and the University of Minnesota at that time, Lillehei told me, had done 48 cases with 22 deaths, so 50% mortality. And that's why people came to Houston. They didn't come here for the weather or the beach. They came here because if you needed heart surgery, it was the best hope for you. Now, this is, once Dr. Cooley got started, we did more heart surgery here than any place in the world. In fact, until 1984, we did more heart surgery at St. Luke's Hospital than all of Western Europe. This is it wasn't a typical day. This was our largest amount of cases. We did 52 cases in one day in 10 operative rooms. Cooley himself did 14 of them. And you can see these were all tough cases. They weren't simple cases that you could just la-di-da through. These mitral valve, tetralogy, rostoli, and et cetera, et cetera. But I remember he left the hospital at 6:30 because he was taking his daughter to the baseball game. And the artificial heart, of course, is what we started with in the early 60s. And Dr. DeBakey was very instrumental in this. He got the National Advisory Heart Council to develop funding, or to give funding to develop a total heart. And Baylor got the most of the money. It was a lot of money. $500,000 in 1963 was a lot more then, of course, than it is now. And one of the reasons, of course, Dr. Bakey was in with everybody, but particularly this was when LBJ had, due to the tragic death of John Kennedy, had become president. And LBJ was very actually forward-thinking. He really did a lot of civic, or very, a lot of good to the country that surprised everyone, certainly me. And this was the first, and it's important to remember this, just if you want to know the history, is that this was the first time that the NIH supported a clinical goal. It's the first time they gave money for a clinical fruition for because prior to that they just gave pure basic science grants. And obviously this was a time we were going to the moon, so making an artificial heart didn't seem like too big a challenge. And
my major goal now, as far as this is, research work is concerned, is
from the early 60s, from this era, and it was certainly Dr. DeBakey's main research goal at the time. Dr. DeBakey became very famous in that era. He was on the cover of Time, he was on the cover of Look, and he was on all the media, which and his sisters, he was also the first doctor, as far as I know, that had press agents, because his sisters acted as press agents and they would always have it in the paper and the media whenever he gave a talk. And but he also, as I said, got the first meaningful support of mechanical cardiac assist. With this, he hired Domingo Leota, who had worked on an artificial heart with a cough and a kutsu at the Cleveland Clinic. He was from Argentina. He'd done some basic work while he was in Argentina. He presented at one of the ASIL meetings. Dr. Bakey was impressed by it and enticed him to come to Houston. Now, Dr. DeBakey, as I told you, was he was very accomplished, but he wasn't really a very warm, fuzzy sort of guy. Dr. DeBakey was a strict disciplinarian. In fact, in his operating room, you couldn't speak unless he spoke to you, and you couldn't unless he asked a question for you to answer, which you better have the answer. There was no sound in the operating room.
Back in the 1960s, Michael DeBakey was one of a handful of leading heart surgeons. He was known as the Texas Tornado.
What do you mean it's not flushing? Yeah, he cut it off. God damn it. I know, but you don't know what I want to do, you see.
Well, Dr. Baikie was quite a taskmaster. He was it was like working under a Marine drill sergeant. It's the patient's life that you're concerned about. And I think Dr. Baikie always emphasized that in a manner that was very forceful.
Never put your hand in front of my line of vision. No. Put your finger over that. You're not concentrating. You're watching me.
His exacting standards brought to Texas a host of luminaries. Marlene Dietrich, the Shah of Iran, and the Duke of Windsor.
Yeah? Yeah. All righty. Well, with all the medical skill of Europe available, why did you come to Houston?
Dr. Baikie.
Everything had to be in perfect order. There was even an order that people had to be in this line that you, when you went on rounds. These are things you heard from him throughout the operation. He was always attacking the resident, and of course we heard this a lot. He actually, I went in one day to talk to one of the anesthesiologists, and he had all his assistants, men in their late 30s, early 40s, standing in the corner while he did an abdominal aneurysm with his nurse, which he could actually do. Anyway, it's a different world. This is something, of course, we heard a lot from him, and it was very, very, very much the case. Had this diagram, but this wasn't actually his diagram, I'm sorry. This was just, gives you an idea of what we were really working for in those days. The left ventricular recovery and device removal was the immediate goal of the LVADs. The idea of long-term support, and of course when transplants started in the 60s, became another secondary goal of the technology. One of the things that was noted by Dr. DeBakey and others, that sometimes when you couldn't get a patient off bypass, simply by leaving them on bypass, sometimes the heart would recover enough to allow you to wean them. This is actually in the first report of the use of an intracorporeal LVAD, long-term LVAD. And in it, he demonstrated how this gave him the idea of using the LVAD as a bridge to recovery by a prolonged support. And in 1966, actually I was on the service then, and I remember this woman very well. It was a 37-year-old woman that actually had to buy an aortic and mitral valve replaced with a ball valves. And most of those patients died, and she, Dr. DeBakey anticipated this, and he supported her for 10 days. She's a very brave woman. Here she is. See, the pump is on the outside of the body, but it was flowing about 2 liters, and it kept her alive. The pump was removed. This is a later, when she came back for a visit, she did very well, and tragically died in a car accident 8 years after this. And this was the first goal of the use of the LVADs, as Dr. Baikie points out. It was designed to allow her to recover. Now, the transplantation sort of came out of the blue. Shumway was working on this, and Dick Lauer, but Chris Bernard actually did the first successful heart transplant. And I got to know Chris Bernard. He's a very entertaining, very cordial guy. You know, all the nurses loved him, and the people that worked with him. He was very, very congenial. And I asked him one time why he thought the first heart transplant occurred in South Africa. And he pointed out that the problem, or reminded me, I knew this, that in America was defining brain death, because you were dead when you lost your pulse. That was a legal definition of death. And so you had to have a pulse if you were going to have a heart that would be of any quality for a transplant. And Dr. Bernard reminded me that in South Africa, you were actually dead when your doctor said you were dead. So he had a little more leeway with the brain death definition. But he really helped, because once he did this, which was in December of 67, then it became much easier in the U.S. To pursue this. Dr. Kanterwitz tried two cases in the U.S., and Dr. Shumway tried a case, and they both died in the first successful case. Here's Dr. Cooley with Chris Bernard. It was done by Dr. Cooley, and this era was a time when there was a lot of attention paid to these heart transplants. And when Dr. Bernard successfully performed the first one, in the sense he got the patient off the heart-lung machine, the patient woke up and was able to be interviewed, and he looked like he was doing very well. And as Dr. Bernard admits here, he died because he over-immune suppressed him, which was a common problem in that era. But he obviously recovered from the operation. As I said, Dr. Cooley did the first patient to live after a heart transplant in Houston. And here's that crowd with Chris Bernard and Lilla High and Ed Stinson and Dr. Kanterwitz. And the first implantation of an artificial heart was done by Dr. Cooley in Houston. And as you can, it was done as Dr. Leota became obvious to him that Dr. DeBakey was never going to implant a total heart. And one of the reasons Dr. DeBakey actually didn't start doing heart surgery until 1960, Dr. Cooley had already done several hundred cases. So he was much more adept than anyone in the world, technically. And I think he felt that this would be a good way to abridge a patient to transplantation. It was clearly a patient that was dying. And Leota brought the heart over, and Dr. Cooley implanted. He sewed it in less than an hour. And of course, here's the first report. And you'll notice the absence of Dr. DeBakey's name in the report. But it was a very important, because it showed that, again, the feasibility of it, not the practicality of it. It was not practical. He died of overwhelming sepsis. He was way over immune suppressed. But it did show that it could be done. Here he is awake immediately after he was brought back to the recovery room. We seldom do that today with our total heart patients. But as I said, he died of overwhelming transplant, rejection.
He didn't do any laboratory work. He was a good surgeon, but that's all.
You know, it resulted in Dr. DeBakey not speaking to Dr. Cooley for another 30 years. Anyway, the failure of heart transplants led us to pursue the mechanical support with renewed vigor. This is one of the early grants that were, this was what they call a request for proposals. And this was 77, actually the first went out in 74. And one of the goals was to have at least 2 years of tether-free, in other words, you could be an outpatient and actually leave the hospital. The first pump to actually be implanted, though, was a temporary pump to allow for ventricular recovery, again, after a heart transplant. Jack Norman was working on this when I came back from Vietnam and started working over here with Dr. Cooley. and Jack Norman. And this went in the retrocolic gutter. It was quite an operation. It lost a lot of blood. It really impaired the use of the coagulation. I'm sorry, the coagulation system. So these patients just bled constantly, and all of them died. None of them left the hospital. We had one patient that lived 6 months, but he lost his arm and both his legs. From that, we began working on this totally implantable pump for long-term use, not as a bridge to recovery, at the same time in the mid-70s. This was a very ingenious pump designed largely by Vic Poirier and Kurt Dossey, working for the company in Boston, and it was very simplistic. It pumped fill to empty. There was not much enthusiasm for it because the transplants, the group began very popular once cyclosporine was introduced, and I did all the implants from 1986 that were done until 1990, and then the group at Columbia became involved, Eric Rose and Menas and Val Jevanandam and others. And the beautiful part about this pump, it's the only implantable mechanical device, surgical device, that didn't require any coagulation. I didn't use any anticoagulation. The group at Columbia sometimes gave aspirin. But the reason is that within 24 hours of implant, the pump was coated with the cells. It did require a console, and the patients had to push this console around. It was approved by the FDA, the first one to be approved by the FDA, because it actually had a control group of patients that, although they met all the criteria for the implantation, they weren't implanted because the company couldn't make enough pumps. And as you can see, the control group was a legitimate control group. And nearly all of the control groups died very early, and the LVAD was very successful on the other hand. The electrical powered pump, which was of course the initial RFP, was implanted in this patient, implanted in 1991, and this was the first patient to actually leave the hospital. And again, this is the pump and operations. This just demonstrates all the paperwork that we had to do and the companies had to support in order to get these approved. Now, the complications, of course, were high, but this pump was also approved by the FDA in 1998. The NIH spent more than $500 million on the research, and the company spent the same amount. So over $1 billion was spent on research of the postal pumps. And they spent nothing on the development of the continuous flow pumps. Rob Jarvik's wife, the Nimbus company that went bankrupt, and I paid for the research in these pumps. I made this statement in 2005, and in fact, they quit making postal pumps by 2012. Now, the continuous flow pumps were largely stimulated by the problem of the durability of the postal pumps. They only lasted 2 years at best, and so they really were just another bridge to transplant. And Dr. Shumway, who I knew very well also, would harass me about this because we had to have a longer durability of a pump. And that's why I started working on continuous flow pumps. Now, nobody else was interested. If anybody tells you that, oh, there was a lot of interest in this at that time, they're lying. And I was there. They're just mistaken, let us say. But because nobody believed in it. And I had a debate in Ohio in 1985 with Glenn Pennington, a very knowledgeable fellow in this field. And he showed us, he kept pointing out to me, he won the debate because of the problem that he foresaw with the baroreceptors causing central hypertension and by loss of pulsatility, and the other hypertension would be the renal hypertension. And both of these would result in a high instance of stroke. And we would also lose the positional reflexes, et cetera, et cetera. And the other problem was the high RPMs to give a meaningful blood flow. And it was felt that if you went above 2,500, it would destroy the blood. And the other barrier that was finite was you had to have bearings for those pumps, and you couldn't lubricate a bearing in the bloodstream. So all of these were felt to be total obvious reasons that continuous flow pump was impossible. Rich Wampler showed me his idea in April of 1985, and this was based on an axial flow pump that they used over 2,000 years ago. We developed this first small pump and implanted it in a patient in 1988, and it was successfully implanted and salvaged a patient from sure death from transplant rejection. This man lived several more years after we were able to reverse his actual problem with rejection. This young boy's heart actually stopped completely, and he was small, but I implanted the pump through a retroperitoneal exposure of the abdominal aorta, and you can see his heart isn't beating at all at this point, and the only flow he has to his body is going through the pump. And this was an important patient to me because clinically it showed you didn't need any pulse at all with these continuous flow pumps. This young boy did very well, and his end organ function was normalized with just a non-pulsatile flow. It was very interesting, and we had a lot of publicity at the time, but as I said, we didn't have the wherewithal to continue the research in the pump. But it was, as I said many times, it was what started the whole interest in continuous flow pumps. Rob Jarvik also was working on blood washed bearings, and we did over 6 years of work with Dr. Jarvik, and we were able to implant pump successfully in the experimental animal by the early 90s. So the hemopump showed that we could have high RPMs and pump blood successfully, and Jarvik showed the feasibility of the blood wash bearings. Those two advances are the basis of all the research and all the pumps that are in use today. Illustrates the bearings, the little red bearings that this is a not a Jarvik, but it was a very good demonstration of where the bearings are in the bloodstream. And we went on to develop what you know now as the HeartMate 2, the HeartWare, and the HeartMate 3. that we don't have good data on all the durability of these pumps. Thoratec kept good records, and they did the best job of that, and we were able to show that the meaningful long-term survival, and we now have patients that have had these pumps in over 15 years, so they've not been pumped to failure. The first centrifugal force pump that we began working on was a HeartWare in 1994. It's a beautiful pump. We could implant it on the diaphragmatic surface, and it could also be used as a right or left-sided pump. It's the first implantable right-sided pump. Vic Poirier and Kurt Dossi, who I'd been working with since the 70s, developed the first HeartWare. And the development of these two pumps showed us that we could use a bearingless pump in the bloodstream, so we didn't have to deal with that. And also, we could put the pump intrapericardially, so there's no pump pocket, and place it on the diaphragmatic surface of the heart. The last research that I want to touch upon has to deal with a totally implantable continuous flow pump. And at the end of last year, there have been over 60,000 of these continuous flow pumps implanted worldwide. And in the US, it's more than twice the number of transplants. And there's no reason to think these pumps won't last 15 to 20 years. So we've certainly solved Shumway's nightmare. And in addition, these patients can return to useful, meaningful, long-term life expectancy. This young man was able to recover his heart function, which I think is going to be another goal that we'll work for in the future. And his pump was removed over 6 years ago, and he's still doing well. This is one of the patients that's had his pump in over 15 years. And the other thing that I didn't anticipate, this young man is 9 years old now, and he had this pump implanted when he was 4, and he's still doing quite well. The last thing is I want to touch on is the totally pulseless heart. As I said, my experience with the continuous flow pump led me to believe that you could have a pump without a pulse at all. This is one of our experimental animals. You see there's no pulse at all in this patient, and it's we actually, Billy Cohn and I, implanted this in a patient, and he recovered nicely, but unfortunately had amyloid that had involved the kidney and the lung and the liver, and we finally had to discontinue his support. You can make these pumps very small. There's just one moving part. This is a magnetically suspended pump, and it pumps to both the right and left side, and has a infinite potential for durability also. And we hope that we'll be implanting this pump clinically within the next 2 years. It'll fit, as I said, much easier and can be totally powered internally. In addition, you can create a pulse with this pump simply by altering the RPMs. So I think we've come a long way with these continuous flow pumps. And I think Dr. DeBakey told me when I was a medical student in the 60s, by 1980 we'll have 100,000 Americans with an artificial heart. I think we'll have that in the future, but he was a little off on the time frame.
We should be able to develop a mechanical pump that will substitute that on. I'm convinced this can be done.
I'm convinced it can be done too, and I think one of the things that I've learned and one of my advantages is I've never looked back, and you can't make an advance by looking back. I had a long conversation with this Irish singer. He never took music lessons, you know, and he thought that was one of the things that helped him the most in his career as a musician, and you always have to remember that creativity is impossible looking back.